was the one that was shot.
He was the mill. He had the mill. Mm-hmm. He had sold the mill. That was her daughter's husband who was killed. He had the mill and he had sold it. The mill had done. He had sold it. It was coming home. Robbers followed him, thinking he had his trucks full of money, and he got clear inside his house and they broke in and killed him. Didn't have money in his pockets. He hadn't brought the money home yet. So the family was out doing chores and they came back in the house. So it was a sad start. And it caused them, as a way to make cash, to plant an orchard. And that orchard was still there, like when you were there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That orchard was still there. The family still owns the ground that it was on.
Yeah.
And we chose the end because they were like a classic example of the pioneer spirit in Livingston County in the early years. Her family, the McCoskeys, her mother's family, I think it was, the McCoskeys were among the earliest settlers that came to Livingston County in the early 1830s before land was even available for sale. They camped on the banks of Shoal Creek the night of the famous meteor shower that they called the Night the Stars Fell. You can Google that and find information about it.
So here are two examples of Chillicothe Hall of Fame. I don't know if you've seen these. It's designed to be a mobile exhibit, but when it's not showing somewhere, it's at the Slice Bread Center at First and Elm Street. Mm-hmm. So that's two of them. So there's a two-page biography, some sponsors, and then this really cool glass cube that they etch, like laser print the photo inside, and then when you turn the light on, it just pops. Really, really cool. Last year, so it's just ending, we're just starting a new cycle. The Edgerton House was on Missouri's Places in Peril, which sounds kind of bad, and it is kind of bad, but in order to get on that, you have to have a sad place that's worth saving and then someone trying to save it. So it's actually kind of a good thing, and they try to help us with publicity. This is the Edgerton House, in case you hadn't been able to quite place what we're talking about. This is a slide I found from 1979. And then this is what it looked like when we bought it. So the first thing we had to do was gather money. That was right after COVID, so the price of everything was awful, and it needed a new roof because it had been leaking for 10 years. So we did finally get the new roof, and we've had to actually redo this one because it continued to leak. And then last December, we took down that porch because it was in really bad shape. The flooring, propped up his chipboard, and we were trying to tear it down. The ladder put a hole in the floor, so I mean, it's really bad. So actually tomorrow we'll be taking down the base of it, clearing it all out so we can rebuild it. And we saved all the pieces we could save. So then, obviously, what we're here to talk about tonight. And did you talk about where the pictures came from? I don't know how to say. So we gathered probably over 300 pictures. For the book, we needed 120. And we went, there were a lot of local families, our local museum, as well as the library, all provided pictures. Arcadia has a formula, so you're allowed, the book total 18,000 words, so depending on how many pictures and how wordy you are, you can do up to 70 words per picture. I think we were at 60 or 65 because we were within like a couple of hundred of the max if we're wordy. And we wanted to put in an index and couldn't even do that. You have to have the 3 to 10 chapters. The chapters have to start on odd pages with no blank pages, and your book has to end on page 127. So, very precise. And just that we are covered the earliest time we could up till 1980. 41 courthouse that went in the square. That's not in the book, but I just like it. It went in the square, third courthouse. We used second courthouse, fourth house we built. And then just into the highway area and cars up to 1950. They didn't want us to go beyond that. Yeah, so this is the full cover, the full picture.
Linda Roberts, who's from the Webb family, donated that picture too. This is why it says Roberts family.
It does. It cuts off the two lads on the far side there. So that's the full picture.
It's a couple of her sons. It's a couple of her neighbors, and then a hired man and his wife that helped her in the orchard. They grew all kinds of fruits on trees. They grew truck farmers. They grew tomatoes and other things like that that they took all over to sell, and they made cash that way. They had a farm, but that's how they made the cash.
All right. I did do this one at the museum, but I did add a little bit new to it, and I think a lot of you didn't see it. This is a picture of P.T. Barnum Circus. I'm pretty sure they're heading south on Locust back to the train depot. 1871. Some places say 1877. I don't know if they came back, but I do know for certain this is 1871. It's really hard when you get the really old photos because there are no landmarks. I was so cool. But I realized right here, and I don't know if you can see it, it says New York store. Mm-hmm. And it was from 1868 to 1871 that Archibald McVeigh and a man named Murray had their New York store there. After, in 1871, they moved it to Washington Street. So I know this has to be within that time frame. I tried to do a zoom in. And then it's a little hard. This may be the Platter Hall, which is next door to the library. Montgomery Ward's is there now. They talk about the shadows of the towers of Platter Hall. No maps show big trees. So I think I've got a map. Yeah. So this is from the 1869 rendering. It's the earliest I can go back for Chillicothe. But I think they're on the second floor here, looking down. This is the only place where I found the storefront with a top facing that way, and then the buildings behind it facing a different direction. And then Platters would be right down here. And the drawings always show these like little tree shrub things, but when you look at the pictures, they're humongous. And this is Archibald McVeigh, as an older gentleman. And this was a drawing, this is the only image I had seen of the original New York store. And you can see it's got a couple of windows and an awning, and if we go back. I think it may just be this small section of the building, a couple of windows and an awning. So I'm pretty sure that that is it.
I know Lockheed Railroad came through Chillicothe and brought a lot of changes and benefits to the city. In 1887, this roundhouse was built. As you can see, it had little bays to do repairs and so forth. And the repair shop was there until 1904. They pull a train in, and this, I don't know if you see it in this one, but this is where they turned the trains around and spun them into one of those bays. In 1904, it was sitting vacant, and there was a sensational robbery story. When a retired Morrisville farmer was held hostage in a deserted train roundhouse, robbed of his entire life savings, and for days the newspaper
But in 1924, when the highway was going through, they tore it down. Apparently, even the governor was saying, hey, maybe we shouldn't do that, but the engineers said they have to. Tree came down in 1924. So Gordon Brown, I don't know when he sold it to Z.B. Myers. Z.B. Myers is the guy who built the Luella Opera House, Luella Graham. He also had a poultry business, and I'm just going to note the
rooster.
I'm just saying. By 1905, it was owned by Carlton, who had a livery in there. And you can actually see it says Carlton at this point. And then some point after that, it became Clark's Hack, which is what the photo was identified with. And I like putting photos and maps together, so you're going to see a lot of that. So here's Washington, Jackson, Cherry. My reference points, Bogey's don't appear. So we come in here and park. Bank is right here. So back here was the livery. And you can see there's a one, I've never seen this, but one almost like dash two wooden structure and then a brick two-story structure. But when you look at it, that's what it is. This is the carriage part wood, and then this is the two-story brick. And Carlton also, when he owned it, he had one of the first Nickelodeons in town somewhere down here. I'm not exactly sure when or where.
I can also tell you that that lot right there, the circle, was where Courtney Wood Oil Company was, if any of you remember it. And there's a picture of that in our book, too. We aren't talking about it tonight.
That's true.
But it's in there, and so that's the same location.
And then one other thing I noticed, due to Stories in Stone, I don't know if any of you went to that. This is Z.B. Myers' tombstone for his family. You can see the little inscriptions. But it's kind of a rounded cone shape with a big ball on top. And then when you look at the top of the livery, rounded cone with balls on top, I'd give anything to know if they were red. Just, I mean, I can't say, but I found that interesting.
All right. I have to talk about the Civil War. I always enjoy reading about Chillicothe area Civil War stories. These are the five last veterans of the Battle of Lexington, Missouri, which happened in 1861. This happened in 1928. They had this reunion. And I can't tell you for sure which one is which. And I really studied. I think I know who this one is, but I'm not sure. I'll tell you about their names and what they did in the war. One of them is J.H. Dyer, and he had three horses shot out from under him during the course of the war, and he fought in all the early Missouri battles. Another one is G.W. Kent, and by the way, he's the only one of the five that didn't have to have a cane to walk. And he had his clothes shot off him times, but he was never wounded throughout the war. He served the whole war without getting wounded, but he lost his One of them is W.H. Manser, and he was the clever guy who came up with an idea at the Battle of Lexington that they should soak the hemp bales and use them as breastworks, which I had to look that up to make sure I knew what it was. It's temporary defensive points. Mm-hmm. And then they were pushing those up the hill. If you've ever been down to Lexington, the river's down below, and you go up the hill to town, they pushed those ahead of them as defense when they took the Confederates took the town of Lexington and won that battle. But he didn't get to do that because before they started pushing the hemp bales up the hill, he was already a prisoner of war. He got taken early in the battle. Captain J.J. Smith was one of few who survived the Battle of Athens. The Battle of Athens was in northeast Missouri. And I don't know much about it, but it was early in the war, 1861. He went through 21 battles without a scratch and was never taken prisoner. And the fifth man is, I think this is him, James A. Shirley. And he was considered the best marksman in General Price's army. I don't know if you guys know this, but eventually joined up General Price's army, and James Shirley went on with Price's army after that battle, and he was wounded in the Battle of Vicksburg in 1863. His leg bone was shot in two. The army surgeons wanted to amputate. He refused it, and he had them carry him to a doctor's private office, and upstairs he stayed there 6 months until he was able to be discharged and come back home, where he couldn't live in Chillicothe because there was so much anti-Confederate sympathy, especially a former soldier. He headed off to California, and there's this mystery story that goes with that, which I won't tell you tonight, but it's pretty interesting. And then his wife, let's shoot the next slide.
Yeah.
His wife, Carrie Shirley, he married her after, she was much younger when he married her. He married her after he got back from California after the war. And Carrie Shirley was the daughter of an early sheriff, Debbie O. Jennings, and also a Confederate sympathizer. And they were married for 60-some years before he died. Carrie and he both were outstanding citizens. That's the point I wanted to make about those soldiers that had the reunion. They came back to town having lost the war, but they got right into the business of being a Chillicothe citizen again and got along with their neighbors. Mrs. Shirley would sometimes crack wisecracks at meetings about her Confederate sympathizing. But she never gave it up. She was a Confederate until she died. And she was also the first lady ever to vote in the First War of Chillicothe. This is the Union side. The Berkshire family has this actual Union roll. And you can't read the names, but it's the Missouri Company G of the 23rd Infantry. And they were very active in the war. They had a lot of Livingston County people in their unit, and they went all the way to the sea with General Sherman. The Berkshires, it's D. Berkshire and his sister Donna Good. Their great-grandfathers were in here, Private Newton J. Hicks and Corporal James M. Wilson. And here's the part I'm going to add that I didn't tell before. James Wilson's parents were friends with Abraham Lincoln. They were all young at the time. And Lincoln came to see the Wilson baby shortly after its birth and said he wanted them to name that baby James Madison after the fourth president who was called the father of the Constitution. And they did. James Madison Wilson. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's in the book. Yes, there's a picture of him and his wife.
Wagon is a Studebaker.
What? Studebaker.
And it was the Dome Boy. wagon for the store.
Okay.
It was in Utica.
That's right. There was the Doan Brothers.
Right, Doan Brothers, yeah.
Store. Ralph married Rosina, who went by Rosa or Rosie in 1898, and they had one daughter, Nadine. Nadine grew up, and she married Earl Mouton in 1923, and they had one daughter, Sue Rose. Sue Rose grew up and married Marion Harger in 1950, and they had one daughter, Rosina. And at least they started out with a 96-acre farm that they inherited from the Baltus side of the family. Is it 80 acres now? I meant to look that up.
How many acres is it?
It said 96 at one point. It's close.
Probably.
Enough.
That was close enough.
Yeah.
The original farm.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And George and Rosina live on that property now. And this is a picture of Rosie or Rosa Doan. This is an oval frame, and it's a bubble photo, so you can't imagine how careful I was to take it out of its frame and gently lay it on the scanner, but I didn't flatten it. But actually, the scan did good enough and came out. But I loved the color. All our pictures had to be scanned black and white, at least 350 dpi. So I took a photograph just with my camera of what it actually looked like in person.
And her hair that looks all curly, that's actually braids.
Oh.
And she was the family story goes that she was the first woman to cast her vote in Livingston County on November 2nd, 1920, the first election where women could vote. I think the women in that family have always been strong women.
You're laughing, George, not laughing.
There you see one of the early horseless carriages. I was really excited when I found that picture. It almost looks like a wagon, but you can see the steering wheel. And that is driven by G.A. McBride with his wife, riding along. That wasn't the first one. The first horseless carriage in Chillicothe came in with the circus of 1900. And school was dismissed so the students could go see the horseless carriage. Shortly, there were three more cars in town. Dr. A.J. Simpson, who was known to give people rides just for fun. Percy Brightman and Mr. Will Gumby were those owners. Another early owner was a Dr. Stevens, and he started driving his new car before he learned how to stop it. So he just drove around the block till he ran out of gas. G.A. McBride and his wife, Mary Nanny McBride lived on South Washington, and they owned a grocery store for 39 years. Meanwhile, G.A., I think his name was George, was also county treasurer and a cashier at the Farmers and Merchants Bank.
I forgot to put a title on here. This came from Vicki Kingman Elliott's collection. I just forgot to put a title on. I think they're from a Citizens Bank.
Oh, yes, it is. It's on the old street side of Citizens Bank.
Socrates England, I like talking about him because he's one of my favorite people, but there will be some new information. He was born in Kentucky. He got married in 1855 to Elizabeth, and on that same day it said they turned their faces to the Golden West. And this is how they had to travel back then. They rode by train to Louisville, then boarded a steamboat down the Ohio River to Cairo, then up the Mississippi to St. Louis. Then they got on a smaller boat, traveled up the Missouri River to Brunswick. And then they got on a wagon and came through Chillicothe up to Trenton. They traveled around a little bit till they settled down in Chillicothe just after the Civil War. This picture is at 516 Jackson. He had his blacksmith shop there. He worked in it until he retired in 1907. For a long time, I didn't know. I figured he's in here, but I don't know which one. I'm pretty certain that's him. Picture. two-story building here. This is Jackson and Elm Street. You'll also notice a brick feed, a wooden agricultural implement, and then you had a wooden warehouse, and then a brick house here as well.
Kirsten, tell me about the Sanborn maps.
Oh, do you guys know about Sanborn maps? They're fire insurance maps. And so for our town, they were done in certain years and only in certain years, and they started out hardly covering any of town. And by the last one's 1927, they covered a great deal more of town. But you can get a lot of great information about a building. Sometimes the building's not included in the map, so that's, I run into that sometimes. Very frustrating.
Yeah.
But it'll tell you roof type, how many stories. It can tell you, like, all these symbols have to do with windows on the first and second floor. They might tell you that there are shutters or that they're tin covered. There's all kinds of things that they tell you. So this is an actual picture of that intersection. I couldn't speak for a while when we first saw this picture. I just can't believe it. It's 1889. I love the handwriting. Precious. This is that brick livery or feed store. This is that wooden agricultural implement for lumberyard, Grace Lumber. And that's not there, so I can't remember what that is. This is the two-story part. It says Young, Brown, and Company Farm Machinery. I'm not sure why. I don't know if Socrates sold that or if he had just bought the building and hadn't changed the sign. But you can see the sidewalks have planks because it looks pretty muddy. And then there's a little white picket fence all the way down. And I didn't include the picture before of the house. So this is that two-story brick house that's right next door. So this is where the Elks Lodge is now on the corner. The big building with the columns is kind of in bad shape, but there hopefully it's going to get better. And then next door was the house. And the house was originally where the county offices were. I think they're on this side, and the county jail was on this side until after the Civil War. 1870, 1872, they built a new jail. And the county building over on Cherry Street, that's both gone now. And then, I don't think this is correct, I think in the interim they sold it to a doctor who converted it into a home, and then he sold it at some point to Socrates England, who raised his family here. And I've just been fortunate enough to run into some of the family, and they showed me the Christmas pictures of the inside. Some of the pictures, the person that I met online, who was a descendant, showed, you know, you see that thing on the fireplace? Well, here it is in my house. It's still in our family, so it's really, really cool. So,
this is a special picture that Mary people had seen, and it is the oldest hospital, St. Mary's, which is a group of nuns built with funding from local families who gave them money regardless of what their religion was. And then in 1937, this is the first brick Chillicothe Hospital that was built on the same lot because Dr. Simpson's wife, he was deceased, Dr. Simpson's wife and Dr. Grace donated the contents of the building and the land for the new hospital. In the old building, there was once a shooting. A doctor who had practiced there for something like 17 years got in an argument with Dr. Grace and pulled a .32 revolver out of his pocket and started shooting. Dr. Grace jumped in the closet, luckily, because the bullet went right over his shoulder into the wall. And nothing ever happened as far as legally. Dr. Grace did not press charges after some of the mutual friends stepped in to mediate. The shooter doctor left town, practiced in Kansas City for 26 more years. So as soon as they got this one opened, they raised that one like this. The next week it was starting to torn down. And I believe Dr. H.N. Grace was the one who did the final surgery in the old building and the first surgery in the new building. He wanted that honor and distinction, so they let him. couldn't get any other sponsors to help. They couldn't find a place big enough. They there was a public outcry for the county to build a convention center, but it didn't happen, and the Farm Congress just died out.
Butter was used exclusively by Harvey Houses, if you've heard of those, the restaurants that all across the country, train stations and on some of the trains. He also did a wholesale grocery business. You can't see it, but I'm pretty sure the rest of the sign is Adams and Sons Grocery. When cars came along, he saw the writing on the wall and got involved with the Highway Association. He became president of three different associations over time. And he helped to dub Chillicothe the Highway City. I like how that happened. Around 1915, there were so many highways going through Chillicothe that I think it was the Blue Book, that, which I'm assuming later became Kelley Blue Book, went to the National Automobile Association, which I assume is AAA today, and said, you know, I don't know what they think they're doing. I think they're making stuff up. So they sent some rep out of Chicago over to Chillicothe to check it out. And I mentioned this to my husband just last night, and he said, oh, they're my, I said, oh, I thought they were like 25. I was a little wrong. Anyway, but they listed every single highway because it had a name, not a number, but, you know, a name. And I counted 18 that went through Chillicothe. So the rep came out, he verified that it was all true, and he went back, and he dubbed us the Highway City. I think part of the reason that Chillicothe is as lively and vibrant as it is now is because he put us at the center of a lot of roads, and that's how we still travel. Let's see, he was instrumental in the formation of Pikes Peak Ocean Highway. I don't know if you've ever heard that. The New York to Los Angeles that came through Chillicothe. He and his son, he's CF, his dad was C.A. Adams. I think his son was C.A. Adams, and his grandson Adams, where the picture came from. So I think C.F. and C.A. Adams, along with Harry Graham, if you've ever heard of him, he needs to be in the Hall of Fame too. They were the first car to ride on Pikes Peak Ocean to Ocean. I got to see one of the scrapbooks from the family. That was really, really cool. Adams was president of that association from 1911 to 1920. And I think originally they had their automobile shop over here in a one-story building. They bought the Platter Barn, the Platter's Hall we had talked about before, tore it down, and built this at the same time as the federal building was going up. So we accidentally have some pictures of it, which is really cool. But you can see Adams Garage, and he was a Dodge Brother dealer. And the first two floors were showrooms. The third floor was the auto repair. And then they did some stuff in the basement. Down there. He lost the building. I think it was bankruptcy in 1928, just before the Great Depression, and the Coburn family bought it, but they did a long-term lease to Montgomery Ward, which is how everybody remembers the building now. So it's a really neat look up local street.
They had a really big elevator in all the cars that were on the third floor, but the cars were a lot lighter than
Isn't there a basement and three floors in, or is there? Okay, yeah, that's what I thought.
This is going back to World War One. I have something you don't know about, Brenda, because I just found out. I think I figured it out Monday. So, 1916, Red Cross chapter. So, the war was going on in Europe, and the Red Cross was spreading across the country. And due to the efforts of Miss Inez Duffy and Josephine Norville here in Livingston County, they got the Red Cross spread throughout our county. So most of the towns had their own chapter, and there were colored chapters for ladies in Chillicothe and in Utica. The Chillicothe Red Cross, well, they didn't have anywhere to meet and do their work, so they started out at Grace Episcopal Church, but that wasn't enough room. So the post very quickly. It was a huge production. They were had lots of sewing machines. They were, because I don't know, what were they making that they had to take up so much room? They were rolling bandages, surgical dressing kits, hospital gowns, bed shirts, pajamas, bathrobes, shoulder wraps, socks, operating gowns, hoods, masks, leggings, slippers, bandages for different kinds of injuries. So different injuries required different bandages, and they learned how to make all those, pack them up, and ship them out. And a lot of sewing machines as well. And you can see there's a lot of ladies here. There's also men. They were involved as well, fundraising events. They had dances, ice cream social, picnics. Sometimes they had special movie showings. The men helped with supplies, equipment, and raising money for the war fund. Now, this picture had no information on it, so we knew it was World War I. We knew it was Red Cross, but we didn't know much else. But I was looking in the honor roll on Monday. That's the 1920 book that Livingston County put out, actually the Constitution, right after the war. And there's a Red Cross chapter, and they have pictures of all the chapter ladies. There's one chapter where the ladies all have head garb on. Only one.
So
I'm thinking it's them, and it was Rich Hill.
Okay, and Rich Hill is Chuma? No, right out this way.
East and northeast, so it includes Sturgis. I didn't really see any other towns. There's a number of churches and schools, but that could be what the, where they are and who they were.
This is a great story. I told that at this of our other history events, but a lot of people have no idea about this. During World War II, the Air Force contracted CBC, Chillicothe Business College, to put on a clerical school to teach airmen and supply procedures. It was a very highly secure thing, and they hired local men to be the guards. The Strand Hotel was leased from Johnny Kling, former Major League catcher. He owned it then. They leased the entire hotel. They took out all the furnishings and equipment from the hotel and brought in the Army's own cots and other equipment and utilized every square foot as barracks, including the coffee shop and the garage. They had that many airmen that were going to come into town for the training. And on November 12, 1942, the Constitution Tribune wrote this. The similarity of CBC to a girls' boarding school, occasioned by the calling of so many boys to the Army, has now vanished. The Air Force has arrived and has the situation more than under control. So the girls were all happy, the airmen weren't too. For the security, Roy Ermacher, who was a former county sheriff, resigned from the city police department to become the director of security, and it was all top secret. He would admit that he hired 9 employees to guard both the classrooms out of the college and the barracks, which was under guard 24 hours a day, so you know he had more than 9 people there. Yeah, but he wouldn't release the names. However, as you read through the old Constitution Tribune, you can pick up things, because sometimes someone like their mother announced, "My boy Johnny got a job with the security force." So they were civilians. They were well armed because Police Chief Dorney asked for people to voluntarily donate handguns for them to carry. And some of them were former law enforcement. So hundreds of airmen men came through the school in waves of 8 weeks. 8 weeks they were trained and returned to duty, and a new group would come in. And suddenly on June 19, 1943, the Air Force closed the school. It was pretty much like, boom, their lease was longer, but they closed it because they had reached their quota and they had enough people trained in the supply line. So the college and the hotel returned to normal, and most guys had to find jobs. Oh, that's my tip. This is Earl's King's Ice Cream Store. How many remember the ice cream?
Oh, I loved it.
What was your favorite flavor?
Well, I loved vanilla. I was just plain vanilla.
Really good.
But my mother loved pistachio, and my grandmother loved black walnut.
Yeah, they had black walnut. I think I wrote some of the flavors they had. My favorite proprietor, Herlis King, also combined the store, which was in the front of their house, with his TV and radio repair shop. And later, he sold the ice cream store, and he and his family moved to 201 Polk Street, where he was into CB radios, and he was active in the Five Watt Wizards CB Club, which doubled as